Move a bit. It's marvellous to see so many people here. Really marvellous. And a tribute to Mitch, which gives the lie to what you might call the truth universally ignored, that the health of children in the community is the most important thing, that those of us who are concerned with the health of children are interested in. Community child health, and I use the words advisedly, community child health has not had a great press. It started out with great aspirations, with the aspiration that I just implied. But gradually over the years became more and more focused, inevitably, on the care of children with specific and life-diminishing problems of various kinds. And as far as the public perception of community child health goes, it was largely a negative one built upon the various disasters which made it to the newspapers. And I'm thinking of those children who, one way or another, society failed in missing the dreadful things that were happening to them. Which makes it, I feel, the more impressive and the greater a pleasure to me that an organisation like my own, Imperial College, puts the weight of its reputation behind a chair which has now been awarded to Mitch, to Professor Blair. And his chair is not in community child health, it is in child public health, and is the first such chair in the country, and returns the focus of attention, and he is going to talk about this, to where perhaps I'm right in saying community child health began, which is the care of the population of children and the way in which, by making various manoeuvres in health and in education and social care, we can ensure their optimum contribution to society in the future. I came thinking that I would tell you about Mitch, but I know that, in fact, you've all been told about Mitch, because in the paperwork that was sent out, it includes a biography. And rather than simply read it to you, I can read it to yourselves. And I'm very pleased to introduce Mitch now to give us his inaugural lecture.
Thank you, Simon. Thank you so much, Simon. Lovely to see so many friends, colleagues, old bosses, new bosses. Really good to see you all, so thank you. You're all very welcome. You've come out on a nice cold March day, and I hope we can brighten you up a little bit. So the title of my lecture is How Are the Kids? Improving Population, Child Health and Development. And one has to ask oneself, how do we know about the kids? And we know about the kids through a number of sources, but certainly one of the common sources of knowledge is the newspapers and the media. And these are some of the stories that have come out in the last few days in this month, looking at different children's problems. So sleep problems were highlighted. Very interestingly, there are more prescriptions now for sleep difficulties in children than there are in adults. So that's interesting. The story about sugar carries on. There's always a story in the newspapers about obesity or sugar content. This one, they've taken the line around cookies and the chocolate chip cookies and average sugar intakes of teenagers. Traffic pollution, and that's been in the news a lot in terms of children's health and well-being. And there is a real issue, I think, perhaps understated, around the effects of pollution on children's lung health and well-being. If you take away the population stories, you also get the very specific stories about when something's gone wrong or something's miraculous. So you get that sort of combination. There was a baby born a few days ago who survived surgery at the youngest age ever done. I think this baby was about 23 weeks gestation and was a sort of world record. Or you get the story, and this is particularly pertinent, in fact, to my hospital, And Richard Nickel, who's here today, as one of my colleagues in neonatology, who has been lobbying for some time to improve the screening for Group B streptococcus. And there's a resurgence that is definitely in the public domain and something that he's looking at specifically. So we get that type of story too. And the story about a unit. This was featured in The Guardian last week. But if we look back a few years, you also get stories about the internet and about computers. This is 7 years ago now, talking about addiction. One of the first places now to be set up to look at computer addiction in the UK in 2010. And something I think many of us with young people in the family recognize, the difficulty in telling children to turn off their computers and what sort of rage they get into. So there's always a story to be had. Now, for David Ellerman, and this is for David very specifically, because I know David enjoys the historical, and I look back at what it was like 100 years ago, and there's a lovely advert, and David doesn't remember this, but he collects, I think, historical tidbits, and this was a lovely one about children who are fretful and feverish who need to have a laxative. So this was an advert for a laxative, front page of the Daily Mirror in March 1917, 100 years ago. But there's also something a little more serious in March 1917. Now, you won't be able to read this very easily, but the middle paragraph talks about the importance of concentrating. This is talking about the way in which healthcare policy is developed in a country. A ministry should form a greater department which would concentrate in itself all the functions relating to the care of children before and after birth that are now distributed over five departments. Sound familiar? 100 years ago. A call to better cooperation and coordination at the top. So you have one source, which are newspapers, the media, but if we look at some of the more interesting epidemiology, we could say that children have succeeded, or we have succeeded in some degree in improving children's health over the years. This is from a report published in the last few weeks from the Royal College of Paediatrics and Child Health, which is looking at the state of child health in the UK. And if you'd like to get a very good summary of what the state, how the kids are now in the UK, this is an excellent report with some very good recommendations. And what you'll see here is what we see in many countries. The infant mortality rates have reduced considerably. These are for the four countries in the UK. And you can see that infant mortality, that is the death in the first 12 months of life, has reduced from 20 per thousand to about 4 per thousand over a 35-year period, which is a good news story. Also, to some degree, we've lost some of the ill effect that occurred with Andrew Wakefield and the MMR scandal, and that some of that has now been repaired in the last few years, and we have to keep our eye on that 90% coverage, if not higher, to ensure the immune state of the population. But we can't be complacent. And one of the things I have learnt through the more recent European work is that we are lagging behind some of our European neighbours, and we are now currently somewhere in the bottom third of the division as far as healthcare of children at that very young age. So although we've had successes, we also have a lot more to do. And what is quite interesting is the effects that poverty have on children. And the effects that poverty in the UK is still a very live issue. And the inequalities between different groups in our society are very stark. And children living in those deprived areas are much more likely to be in poor health. They're much more likely to be overweight or obese or suffer from asthma. or experience mental health problems and die early. And those inequalities need to be adjusted, and that is a focus that is very, very clear in that report. To give you some idea, here is a graph showing the proportion of mothers breastfeeding at 6 weeks of age by level of deprivation in the population. You have the most deprived quintile, the most deprived fifth, and the least deprived fifth, and you can see the exclusive and mixed breastfeeding rates are quite disparate according to deprivation, which tells you that some of these pathways start very early on in life. And this is one of the things that has actually driven me in my career and got me very interested in how we promote and protect children's lives from a very, very young age, because those trajectories are very, very clearly set at a very early age, as I'm going to demonstrate. So one might say it is easier to build strong children than repair broken men. And I think that has been a philosophy that I would aspire to too. Now, I'm going to focus on three things. Well childcare and how well childcare has developed in this country. Monitoring the child population, and I've mentioned a little bit about that. And then at the end, just touch on some future work that I'm doing with colleagues in Imperial, looking at complex service interventions, and with my colleagues in the European MOCA project. That is my mother, who's sitting here, so I'm delighted that you're here, Mum, with me. And this is a sort of clinic that I used to go to. Well, not quite, but this is a clinic, a well-child, well-baby clinic in Oxfordshire.
Site to a place where strange sights, especially the pink elephant variety, are almost commonplace, the local. But here's one even we never expected to find, for it seems at first glance that babies from the village of Great Tew in Oxfordshire, poor things, are brought up on the bottle in both senses of the word. However, before you dash out and write to the Times, let's explain there's nothing sinister about the refreshments they get here. In fact, what goes on is no different from that at any infant welfare clinic. The setting may be rather unorthodox, but notwithstanding, every fortnight the pub becomes just that, a clinic. This must be the only pub in the country where they measure half pints in pounds and ounces. And this half pint's not too keen on the idea. Apart from the possible danger of the medical officer occasionally picking up a discarded dart instead of his hypodermic, this might well be a doctor's surgery.
So that was a bit of fun. So in the 50s, pubs were being used as clinics, and it was actually a very big news story when a clinic actually opened in an area, so much so that it was front page of one of the Leeds newspapers in 1949 when they opened a new welfare clinic. But there's all sorts of practices that were occurring, and this is a strange placeholder, but it goes on to show you.
4-month-old Yolanka was a little lady being given a good start for the future by Professor Yaroslav Koch at the Institute for Mothers and Babies. The exercises come under the heading of early motion stimulation, designed to set up baby for a healthy life ahead. In the tender care of the professor, the little miss seemed to be enjoying herself. The exercises last for an hour every day. Baby gets the minimum of help. Self-reliance begins at this tot's gymnasium. Another pupil is 5 months old Miroslav, a young lad who's already keen to show off his muscles.
So I wanted to show you that because that's a lot of interesting practice that was taking place. And one of the big challenges in world childcare has been, in fact, to identify the evidence base, the scientific evidence base behind it. And I got very interested in this quite young when I was doing a Bachelor of Science at UCL in sociology and philosophy with my colleague, who's a general practitioner. Where is he? Alan Shamroth. Where's Alan? Yeah. So we had a lot of fun looking at, this was us being taken out of the 35-hour week, which was a typical medical school week, into a sort of 11-hour or 12-hour tutorials in a whole week, and lots of reading and lots of fun. So I got very interested in the history of the development of children's medicine, but also in some of the philosophical aspects of provision and how services were provided. That little girl in the picture was the first baby I delivered. She's now 37 years old, and from Ipswich a long time ago. And I continued that interest in children and babies in San Francisco when I was doing an elective placement in pediatric endocrinology, where in fact I met this gentleman in the bottom right with the superb moustache of the 1970s and 80s. And that gentleman was one of the first people I met who was an adolescent specialist. So Dougal, where are you, Dougal? So you might like to know that in the States, certainly, even then, there were adolescent pediatricians, which I think took how many years before we had them in the UK? Another 34 years or something before we had our first chair in adolescent medicine. So 1983, I qualified. my sister is sitting there in the front, very embarrassed. I started my pediatric training and went to Charing Cross Hospital, where I met with Ewan Ross and Ilya Kovar, and was introduced to a two-year rotation, which was quite unusual at the time, which took me in from the hospital into very, very intensive neonatology, out into the community, into clinics, in well baby clinics, in school health, in special schools, in child development center. And that was very innovative at the time. And I'm very grateful, because 2 years in one place actually gives you a lot of continuity and is quite rare to find these days. I then went on to Great Ormond Street, where I did a job, a strange job, with a mixture of immunology, dermatology, and neurosurgery. It was a bizarre job, but I learned a huge amount. And then in Northwick Park, I was very fortunate to meet two extremely innovative pediatricians, Bernard Valman and Judith Wilson, who actually, and Mike Lieberman, and between them, they had really modelled and developed absolute cutting-edge integrated pediatric services. And this was a long, long time before people started talking again about integrated care. And they published the first few articles about that in health trends, in the policy journals of the time. And that was a very happy time for me. And they were holding me until I got an MRC training fellowship when I went to the Institute of Child Health and worked with Eva Alberman, who was an epidemiologist who, at the London Hospital, and who taught me and got me very excited about epidemiology, particularly around congenital malformations. And where I met Helen Bedford, who's now a professor at the Institute of Child Health, and we are now running, both of us are running masters, having both been on them or taught on them right at the beginning in 1989-90. And then I married my lovely wife, Susan, who hasn't changed a bit, and we moved to Nottingham. In Nottingham, Nathan was about, I think, 6 weeks old or 8 weeks old when we moved, and then Alicia came shortly after that. And in Nottingham, I was delighted. I went to Nottingham very specifically because there were two places in the country that were absolutely top-notch for community pediatric training, and that was Newcastle, where Alan Colver is, and Nottingham. And they had written in the BMJ, and they'd written about their programs, and I was determined to go there. And Leon Polnay acted as a superb mentor to me, and later a consultant colleague when I was appointed a senior lecturer from 1990 to 1998. And whilst I was there, I got very interested in doing some research in Nottingham with the Department of Health, which was to look at this whole issue about the changing context of preventive care. If we think about what were prevalent conditions back in the early 20th century and the mid 20th century, the issues that we were trying to tackle then around infectious disease and malnutrition and sensory impairment and deformity gradually subsided to some degree and got replaced with a new set of problems, the so-called new morbidities, or the millennial morbidities, they became later known. This concept was described by Bob Haggerty in the States in the 1970s, and really it is a very relevant issue for us now in terms of our training. Are we training doctors to tackle these issues? Is it, in fact, a doctor's business? And I would argue that this is a mixture of the two. We do need to train, and we do need to work closely with other agencies, because these are multiple causal issues. They are difficult, knotty, and wicked problems to solve. But the World Childcare, or Preventive Childcare Programme, needed to be examined in detail. And the three research questions that we asked ourselves in Nottingham were, what was the quality of the programme itself at the time? Did it help to detect the key conditions it was aiming to seek out? And what did parents think about it? At that time, there were two services really that existed, a whole group of medical officers of health who were originally employed by the local authority and now gone back into the local authority, and school nurses, no longer employed by local districts, and they moved to the health service and were integrated with paediatricians. In the 80s and 90s, health visitors became attached to general practitioners and were much more closely allied than they are perhaps now. And GPs had an incentive for preventive care in that they were remunerated specifically for improving screening and improving immunisation in particular. Health visitors and medical officers at the time were very geographically based, so they got to know a community very well. And that was a very important aspect in Nottingham and in Newcastle, in that they had devised their services in geographical areas. So paediatricians got to know their general practitioners, health visitors and school nurses extremely well. We trained each other, and we regularly shared premises, record systems, and clinical facilities. So there was really an intermingling that took place, which is actually being reinvented now, some many years later, in a different and better format. So we had this rather separate system of curative care provided by GPs and preventive care by medical officers and health visitors. And the Department of Health wants to know in the late 1980s, early 90s, which way to go. Do we invest our money in general practitioners? Do we invest our money in medical officers and health visitors? Which system is better? And at the time, the program was terribly variable across the country, and a lot of time was spent on rather poorly evaluated practices. A national working party was set up, convened by David Hall, president of the Royal College, later president of the Royal College of Paediatrics. And this was the first time that the scientific evidence base was actually being collated and put down on paper as a program for practitioners. At that time, there were a number of different components to the program, starting within the first few hours of birth, with a general physical examination, particularly looking for physical defects of the eyes, heart disease, hips, and general weight and head circumference measurement. And then a hearing test done within the first week, and support thereafter for weight and breastfeeding, and later blood spot tests, biochemical tests of the blood taken from the heel of the baby to check for serious diseases that will be reversed or ameliorated by early diagnosis. At 6 to 8 weeks, there was a general physical examination usually carried out by a doctor, and then immunization and further hearing tests, immunizations, boosters, visual assessment at 4 or 5 years of age, and then further growth and other measurements done at school entry. No further screening at primary school, and then further reviews at secondary school, particularly vision at the time, but also general well-being. So that was the current, that was the program at the time that we were looking at, and this wonderful innovation came into place. This was the parent-held child health record, the red book that many of you might have if you've got young children. And that book was developed from an African template. So it was a book that was developed by Dr. Morley in Africa to try and record weights and heights and growth in African children. And that concept came over to the UK and got further developed. And so we were able to have a record system, which Helen Bedford, in fact, still chairs the record group that is devising and moving this through into the 21st century now. But what it did allow us to do was collect data from all the children seen. And over a 12-month over a 12-month period of births in 28 practices in Nottingham, we looked at 2,300 infants, and we wanted to see for five key conditions: hearing, heart disease, hip dislocation, squint, and testicular problems, maldescent. We wanted to see what the pickup was, what the detection was, and also what the processes were. And what we noted, and I think we were quite surprised, is about one in five children had been referred to the hospital. One in five children had been referred to the hospital for further testing, which is an enormous amount of people, of whom just over 10% had a definite abnormality, for those that we could check. And what this showed us was that the predictive value of these tests was relatively poor, except for testicular maldescent. And the false positive rates were rather high, which meant that a lot of children would be falsely classified. So you might say that was this screening test, set of screening tests, effective for detecting these conditions? It was effective, but it wasn't very efficient. And it was problematic, or it could be seen to be problematic. What was also interesting is that the health professionals were recording the types of issues they were seeing at the different ages. And what we see here is a list of conditions, of skin problems, of hearing concerns, sticky eyes. These are very common conditions seen in the first few months of life, and actually acted for the first time as a record of the sorts of issues that people would need training on, health professionals, to build up their confidence in dealing with these conditions. Were parents, the third element that we wanted to ask, were parents satisfied with the situation? And we decided to set a standard with parents that said that 90% of parents, or should we put it the other way around, less than 10% would have a poor understanding of what was done at the 6-week baby check, or did not have time to discuss their worries about their baby at the six-week check. And so those standards were being met. In other words, most parents were actually receiving what they wanted. Less so, perhaps, was the time taken to ask questions, or for that matter, feeling particularly welcome at the baby clinic. Or the purpose or the results being well explained. So there were some issues about the way we communicated about the well child checks. Also, we wanted to know, for many countries, these are, for many Scandinavian countries, these reviews are extremely well carried out for the large proportion of the population. But in the UK, we didn't really know what the proportion of children who actually had these checks was until we started collating this data. You see a slight drop-off in time for between 4 weeks and 10 months. And what we then looked at was nationally in Scotland, we wanted to look at that coverage by deprivation. And what we noticed is that actually there's no difference between the least deprived and the most deprived children in terms of getting their checks done in a timely fashion until you get to the higher ages. And as you get older, there is a steeper curve and a bigger difference. So what does that tell us? It tells us that we are failing to cover a vulnerable group of children for whom these tests might benefit considerably at later ages, particularly in the area of speech and communication and language development or behavioural problems. So there's something about the way we operate the system that needs to rebalance the, where possible, the coverage across the different social groups. So that was the first set of questions, really, that the Department of Health wanted to look at. We took both primary care, both general practice settings, and health visitor medical officer settings, and we did not, in subsequent research, we did not find a significant difference between the two ways of delivering. So for the grant they gave us, we weren't really able to show any major difference, and they gradually shifted the preventive program into general practice settings. We were also interested at the time in Nottingham to look at the effectiveness of health visiting. And we carried out a systematic review with Jane Robinson in Nottingham, the professor of health visiting in Nottingham, and a health economist and others, and we actually came up with some very interesting findings. This is a graph showing what is known as a meta-analysis of studies. So this is taking a group of studies, looking at breastfeeding at 3 months of age and asking themselves, does health visiting improve breastfeeding at these at 3 months of age? Does it have an effect on breastfeeding rates? And there are four studies there, and you can see that they vary in their effectiveness. So this is, if there's absolutely no effect, it would be the one. If there was a negative effect, it would be in the below one, and a positive effect, it would be above one. And when you look at these four studies together, a very small number of studies, you can see a just about positive effect of health visiting on breastfeeding. And summarizing 300 pages of report into two columns, on the left, you see what we found from the studies that existed with Ruth Elkin, which interventions were effective for health visiting and which were not or of questionable a questionable impact. I'd like you to note the bottom one in particular, because this is something that I've started to re-look at in terms of emergency department or hospital admissions. Can health visitors have an impact, particularly on the very young coming into our A&E departments or our urgent care centres? few years later, a very important set of studies came together in an excellent review article in JAMA, the Journal of the American Medical Association, which actually starts to look at the neuroscience, the neuroscientific basis of child development, looking at the roots of health disparities and suggesting a new framework for health promotion and disease prevention. This slide is a summary, if you like, of a very important set of observations which we were taught at medical school initially. So the idea that the eyesight, if you take a kitten and you take a newborn kitten and you keep one eye occluded and you let that kitten grow, that one eye becomes effectively blind as the kitten grows. And that work was done by Zeki and others back in the 1970s, and we were being taught that at medical school at that time. But the same could be said for all these other systems. If you don't support a child sufficiently well with language development in these critical windows of opportunity, of sensitivity of the neurons, of the nerves connecting, you don't get the maximum impact. The same with emotional control or peer relationships or the auditory, the hearing system. And what you see from this is there's this peak around 2 years of age, this peak of sensitivity of the nervous system to the environment. And what the previous set of papers was describing is the importance of well childcare or preventive childcare activity that was effective within that window of opportunity. Many of you will have seen this picture before. It is a picture that is often shown to people who don't quite believe the story. That is, if you take twins who have the same genetic material, but you put them in two different environments, one which is extremely abusive and neglectful, and the other isn't, it really affects the brain literally within the first 3 years of life. And these are two scans, MRI scans, showing brain growth of those twins. And Michael Marmot, Sir Michael Marmot, in his report on trying to address health inequalities, has reiterated the importance of the early years, and again perhaps in adolescence, where there's this other critical window of neural development, two critical windows which we need to be very, very much aware of, which impact on us in terms of the accumulation of positive and negative effects on health and well-being. He, in fact, in 2010, went as far as to say, if there are six things that really would make a difference to reduce health inequalities in our population. And he starts with two of those, which are children and young people related. Give every child the best start in life and enable all children and young people and adults to maximize their capabilities and have control over their lives. And what we see is that from Nobel Prize winning economists, John Heckman and others, that the evidence is quite strong, the scientific evidence, for investment in the preschool years. But in truth, typically investment increases as you get older. So the optimal investment levels for return, the $1 that you put in, or the £1 you put in the early years, will return at least £7 or up to £10 in return if you look at that early investment and you put in place interventions in those early years. I worked for 8 years in a school for children with emotional and behavioral disability. This was a school for less than 30 people, 30 children from the whole county of Nottinghamshire. Westbury School. That school had, of those 30 children, there were 25 teachers. Those children could not be contained in mainstream schools. Those children's behaviour and their emotional well-being was very severely damaged. They were the typical children and young people who graduated to places like Glen Parva and other youth offending institutes. And when you do the costings and you look at the per child costs for these young people, and a very wonderful Australian registrar called Honey Heusler and myself, we looked at these children's records and we looked back to see what was happening in the first 2 or 3 years of life. And we found the most extraordinary adverse events occurring. And this was back in, this is quite a long time ago now, it was back in the early 1990s. And at that time, the neuroscience had only just started to come together. So I felt that with that type of spend, and if you look at what we're spending on preventive care, it's relatively small compared to what the per child spend is in the criminal justice system. And I felt when I moved to London, moved back to London in 1998, that I wanted to dedicate more time to look at how we can improve those early years trajectories. Those children in that school often were coming from very poor backgrounds, often did not get health services. 100% of them did not attend at least 3 appointments at hospital. Family discord was quite common, but some of the protective factors that might support a better trajectory are shown below here and have been shown quite clearly to make a very big difference. Reading to your baby. You can start reading to your baby extremely young, and it does have an important effect in that very sensitive neurological window. There's a pediatrician called Zuckerman who has for years been working in the States on Reach Out and Read, a program to actually take books into pediatric practices and start parents to get thinking about reading and stimulating their infants at a very young age. And that program now reaches 5 million children at the moment. I moved back in 1998, back to Harrow, because I wanted to be back in London, and I was very pleased to be offered a new position that Judith Wilson made possible as a senior lecturer in paediatrics, and allowed me the opportunity to develop paediatric undergraduate education in a new setting. Harrow, for those of you who don't know, is up in the northwest of London, and is literally, the hospital is one of the interesting greenfield site hospitals, which means that it's known as a village hospital, which means that it can expand. It has no money, but it can expand if it wanted to. And that hospital has been expanding. And next door to that, if you look at the map, is Harrow School, playing fields. And I mention that because of this famous baby. And so I know a lot of you in this room have seen this slide before, but I don't know if those of you who haven't been in this room can guess who this is. He looks much the same. He was a famous Harrow School boy. What's interesting also about Harrow School is that the Earl of Shaftesbury in the 19th century was a boy at that school. And the Earl of Shaftesbury in the 1830s, I think it was, saw a cart going across the road in Harrow School, where he was. He saw a cart carrying a coffin. And unfortunately, the horses jolted, and the coffin, the end of the coffin, came apart. And this boy, 11-year-old boy, fell out of the coffin onto the floor, onto the road. And the Earl of Shaftesbury at the time, he wasn't the Earl of Shaftesbury, he was a little boy then, he was 10, 11 years old, wondered how on earth could a boy of that age have died and why? And he went down the road to see where this boy came from. And literally down the road from Harrow, literally down the road, even now, is a very, very deprived part of our borough. It is one of the most disadvantaged parts of the borough. And interestingly enough, its infant mortality is about 17 per thousand. The best infant mortality in our borough is 2 per thousand. And he really was taken by this, and he wondered why this 11-year-old boy had died. And he'd been working in the factories. And this was the start of this gentleman's political career. He was a boy, but he went into Parliament and he passed the Factories Act, which stopped young children from coming into factories. And that was a very powerful example of advocacy and something that I think I've learned an enormous deal, enormous amount from Leon Polnay and colleagues who have been the most staunch advocates for some of the most disadvantaged children in this country. So we move on. In 1998, in my new role, by then David Ellerman and David Hall had reviewed the evidence yet again and were starting to set new parameters to the programs of care. By then, I was also interested in looking at the slightly older child, looking at the children at school entry. And what we had noted was there was no real good tool to actually look at children at age 5. So if you take the whole population at age 5, could we develop an evidence-based tool for assessing the child population at that age? And with Sarah Edmonds and very good colleagues at the Royal College of Paediatrics in their research division, we did develop and test a system called CHASE, Child Health Assessment at School Entry. And we had a number of evidence-based tools. And I ask you to look particularly in this red block here. And this is a school in, we had two boroughs that we tested this out in. And what we were able to see in a very standardized and objective way was the proportion of children with chronic long-standing illness or disability in the schools, the immunization uptake, obviously, but also things like child well-being and quality of life around physical functioning, around children's environment. And we were quite shocked, I think, in this borough to find that 8% of the kids in that particular test, in that pilot, 8% of them had been in temporary accommodation in the last 2 years. That's at school entry at 5. They'd been in bed and breakfast, they'd been in temporary hostels, etc. That was not known before. We also noted at that time the proportion that were overweight, and that was before the national measurement scheme had really come into play. And we also noticed that dental health was particularly poor, about 23% at school entry. And still to this day, so 2017, oral health in that borough is the priority area. Eustace D'Souza, I saw his name was there. Eustace is there. Eustace will know that a lot of London is currently very seriously affected by high prevalence of oral or dental caries and dental poor hygiene, and is a major plank of Public Health England's approach in London. Marilena Korkadolis, I think, is working with a number of dental officers in London to try and address this, because it is the commonest operation that is done on children, and people don't know that. Dental extraction is now the commonest operation of all of children. So that was a very useful tool that got embedded in a computer system and then lost, because computer systems get lost. But I hope perhaps we might get that back again, because it was a very good standardized tool and it piloted well and had good psychometrics. In 2009, I was very fortunate to go and work with the Department of Health, and I was very fortunate to get a taste of how programs are put together at government level, at policy level. And I was invited by Sheila Shribman at the time to, and this I put down here the aims of the program, because it's quite clear that the aims there had shifted from a few years back, with a much, much stronger focus on attachment and positive parenting and well-being, and this concept about readiness for school and improved learning. So there was a very good focus on what are clearly the issues that need to be focused on for modern 21st century children. I was lucky enough to produce a national policy document, this two-year review, which gave very specific guidelines for practitioners at key points based on the evidence from the neuroscience literature and implementation science, and that became a national program for all two-year-olds now in the country. Incidentally, some conditions come back, and rickets has been a worry for us in the UK, because we feel that rickets probably has increased in its admissions to hospital, certainly, and the supplementation program has been up till date really appalling. Not because we've not tried, it's just not been good enough for the population. And I'm working closely with Michael Leviton, who's here today and is in charge of the community pharmacies in the whole of Northwest London, to try and address this with others, including some of the manufacturers of vitamin D, to improve both the quality of the product and the dispersal of the product in the population. We actually wrote to the chief medical officers, and all countries have actually made a very strong recommendation that all children and all adults now should be taking vitamin D in the winter months, and certainly all children vitamin D daily until the age of 5. A difficult problem, and this is the issue about the quality. We've done this was with Bernard Valman's help, and our community and our pharmacist at the time in the hospital, looking at the quality of the products, which showed a huge variability. So you go to the chemist, or you get prescribed a product, which is you go to the over-the-counter and go to the chemist, you will see a huge variation in the concentration of vitamin D in the products. This is now recognized, and there are now products which are far closer to being accurate than there were. At the same time, we want to look nationally at rickets and the prevalence of rickets, the incidence of rickets, I should say, in the population. And with the Royal College of Paediatrics and the British Paediatric Surveillance Unit, this sends out a notification to every single paediatrician in the country to ask them if they've seen a case in the last month or so. And so far, we've picked up about 70 cases nationally. Around 3/4 of them are between 1 and 3 years old. 90% of them have dark skin. And 90% of cases, there have been no supplements taken. A 19th century disease that has come back. Is it a problem? Well, our data is very worrying. We've had 3 children who've had cardiomyopathies who've actually died as a result of vitamin D deficiency and rickets. So you could argue it's a small number of children, but it's a totally preventable disease. And therefore, we are in need now of an appropriate intervention program for that. I'm going to very briefly touch on these two topics in the last few minutes, which is about monitoring the child population and complex service intervention and redesign. And for this, and this is what I'm currently very busy with at the moment, with my wonderful colleague Michael Rigby, Professor Rigby, and with Denise Alexander and Christine Chow, and 83 people across 30 countries in Europe now, looking at the way in which primary care services are being delivered for children in a European Union-funded project called MOCA, Models of Child Health Appraised. But that project started with a look at, with a simple question: how should we measure child health in Europe? And we knew that we needed to set up or put together a set of indicators that would tell us how well children are doing over time. Indicators are used to monitor national and local policies, but also stimulate new development and develop hypotheses. And our particular project looked at, with 15 countries at the time, looked at recommended indicators at national level and a full appraisal of the evidence base. I won't go into this in too much detail, but only just to say that our philosophy was very much that death and illness were too late. And to measure death and illness doesn't really tell you about the health of the child population. It's important, but it's too late. We need to look at the determinants of children's health and what could be prevented, what diseases can be prevented, which is far more important. We also need to be mindful of the burden of ill health, particularly with issues such as asthma and allergy, which have increased considerably, but also with increased survival of children who would otherwise have died and clearly are in need of longer-term care. So we developed a set of indicators based on these topics. And I think you'll agree that this probably reflects not only the professional perspectives, but also the parent and child perspectives to some degree about what they felt, what people feel are important to measure in terms of indicators for the population of children in Europe. A number of shortlisting criteria were used, which are seen on the screen there. And importantly, we want these indicators to be amenable to effective action. So you want to be able to see over time that you made a difference. And clearly, the data needed to be available. And that wasn't such an easy task. So I won't dwell on this too long, just to say that we did look at a number of different indicators or put together a suite of indicators, both for morbidity and injuries and mental health, but also some of those wider determinants that I mentioned before. Some are more traditional, like immunization coverage, but some were a little more unusual, like exposure to hazardous noise or environmental tobacco smoke. And Michael Rigby put this together very well as a toolkit, and which actually then was used in 2005 to help inform a cross-European strategy for child and adolescent health and development. So that work that was done in putting that suite of indicators together then became embedded within WHO policy and documentation. 10 years later, it has been very difficult to get each statistical office to collect that data in a consistent way. And although we've had some success in a number of countries, that suite needs to be further developed. And that was one of the recommendations of this UK state of the UK's health report as well. And finally, And I just wanted to move from monitoring the child population to complex service intervention and redesign, and just give you two examples of work that we've been done. I don't know if Ingrid Wolf is here, but Ingrid led the way in looking at some of the data that existed across Europe. And we published a paper in The Lancet looking at European data, published in the BMJ, Ingrid published the mortality rates for UK and a number of other countries, showing that the black line, if you look at this black line, the UK has slowed up in terms of its improvements compared to the other countries. And this actually hit the press in a big way. And in a subsequent paper in The Lancet that we published, looking at why, this was just to show you, for one topic, this is the proportion of children with wheeze and the 10-year mortality rates for asthma. And what you will see here is that the asthma mortality rate is extremely high for children in the UK, which is a surprise. It's really surprised people that it was, and people didn't believe the data. So perhaps this was a diagnostic classification error. But in fact, there have been a number of coroner's reports in the last year or so, and I think some of you will have read in the paper, this week there was a child who passed away unnecessarily from asthma, not being able to get the medication in time or not having the disease recognised. So there are still issues about how we are treating this common chronic disease. Unfortunately, some have been blamed, this was an independent newspaper report, which was very mischievous, and just shows you how careful one's got to be with the press, because it was a very simplistic and probably quite wrong explanation. But it did stimulate a question. Does the type of primary care make a difference if you've got half of Europe with primary care paediatricians and another half with general practitioners? Does it make a difference what type of paediatrician is out there? Does it make a difference to children's health? And that was the fundamental question within MOCA. If you look at the different types of system that exist in Europe, this is from 2010 work, showing three different types of system: paediatrician-based, which is the very dark one, GP or family practice-based, which is the grey, and a combined system, which is the intermediate colour. And you can see a slight east-west, north-south divide there. And what's interesting is that if you look over time, over a 10-year period, the paediatric system, the primary care paediatric system, has dropped, and the combined system has dropped, and the GP family doctor system has increased in prevalence. And there are a lot of professional interests involved here. And the question really was, does it make a difference? So this project was funded in part, not entirely, but in part, to try and answer that question. And Mike and I are leading this with a great team with 19 partners in Europe. And we're looking at whether what defines these models. Are there differences in record systems or the type of personnel? The way it's funded, the way in which the systems can actually address inequalities. What are the important social, cultural, and political influences on the way the systems get developed? And particularly, and Maria Brenner in Dublin has been really majoring on this, what is the interface between primary and secondary care for very complex children? Denise and I have developed with MOCA this framework, which is basically saying, building on the work that I showed you before, that there are many different determinants of children's health. Clearly the family and the community, but primary care makes a very important contribution. and is connected to all those elements. But to what degree does primary care make a difference to children's health and well-being? And you can see as the child gets older, the different influences, so for example here at 10 to 14, community, peers and school becomes a much more important influence to some degree than the immediate family and peers. And as you get even older, you're more sensitive perhaps and more aware of social, political, cultural contexts. And we wanted to take a life stage approach and look at the structure of the primary care systems. How well do they recognise problems, treat disease, empower and advocate for children, and is the system affordable, appropriate, continuous? Is it coordinated? And most importantly, are the right outcomes being achieved? You could argue that the bottom part is really to do with a system-centred view and the top part with a child and youth carer-centred view. And we use a number of tracer conditions to try and test the systems out looking at this. So for Europe, the different systems in colour here, the paediatric in green, it's changed now, this is the most up-to-date, general practice in yellow, it has changed, and we asked ourselves which system has a better diagnostic ability. And we took autism as a particular condition along with others. Oops. And if you see the red here, this is the months, the age at onset of diagnosis for pediatric systems and general practitioner systems. And there's a significant difference between these two, but only for that particular disorder. Not for ADHD, not for Asperger's or autistic spectrum disorder, but for the more severe end of autism. And that begs some questions. Why would GP systems be better at diagnosing autism or be have it at an earlier age? Is that because of the family context in general practice? Or is it some other factor? We don't know. If we look at immunisation coverage, is it better? Which system is better? And this was showing really that the family practice in the mixed countries had an improved coverage compared to the pediatric primary care countries. I mean, that's 48 studies. But no difference for asthma care, for instance, chronic disease care. So these are rather simplistic ideas. It really is a model based on a lead clinician. But there are many other factors that are likely to be involved. So the next steps for the project is actually analysing some of these responses from our country agents, the 30 countries involved, to look at whether there are other elements that need to be taken into consideration. And finally, literally right at the end, I just wanted to say something a little bit about the UK and child public health in relation to health services. This is quite an interesting London Health Commission report showing you the spend, the size and spend on different individuals in London for children. And what you see here is that the population size is greatest for mostly healthy children. There are five groups, five segments, if you like, of the population here. And you can see that the population size diminishes as you look at the more intense end of the spectrum. But what you see is the spend per person is relatively low for the mostly healthy children. Well, I shouldn't say relatively low. It is relatively low compared to mostly healthy young people, adolescents, with these higher spends per capita for the more intensely ill. But if you take the population size, this is a very big spend, 2.10 billion for that population, for mostly healthy children who are seeking help for acute illness. And here is a graph showing in our hospital the attendances of males and females coming into the hospital for all ages. And other than the over 80s, there are two peaks that you see in young people. It is the under fives and the late adolescents, young adults. And this is a very striking picture, particularly if you look at the under ones. That's just a 1 year age group. So these are very large attendances in the ED, which perhaps if you were reading the newspapers, you wouldn't appreciate necessarily that that's such a large group. And Michelle Hayes and other colleagues and medical students involved with this work were looking to see why the children under one were coming into hospital. And a vast proportion of them, about one-fifth, even when we looked at the records in detail, about one in 10, there was no medical reason known. So 6,500 babies under one were coming into the emergency department. And 10% of those, there was no medical reason. What does that tell you? It tells you that parents are not able to cope or don't feel able to find help elsewhere. And so I've turned some of my attention in terms of well baby care, I have turned some of my attention to trying to answer these questions. And with Michael Leviton, we're hoping we might be successful in trying to look at how pharmacies can be much more involved and self-support and supporting parents. We're looking with Amanda Watson and Bob Klaber at how the primary care system can improve that interaction and reduce some of the unnecessary attendance. We're working with Ian McConaughey, who couldn't be here tonight, to look at how NHS 111 telephone services work. And with our local urgent care team, we have a wonderful MD who's working on, Ben Holder, who's working on how can we influence parents who are coming in through educational methods and others, text alerts and audio alerts to improve the experience that they have in the ED department. I have a number of colleagues here from the Collaboration for Leadership in Applied Health Research and Care, and I thank them because they helped to fund some of that work for the first 2 years, which is a Northwest London collaborative. And I'm working very closely with the data analysts and others at pulling together data from the hospital, from the public health department, and elsewhere to try and get a better understanding of this system. And I just want to finally give some acknowledgements. Having taken you through well baby care, having taken you through pan-European work, and now back looking in micro detail at A&E. I wanted to just thank, there are a lot of people to thank, but I particularly wanted to thank my old bosses. I particularly wanted to thank my trainees and my medical students who've been a fantastic support. I particularly want to thank my children, Nathan and Alicia, who've had to put up with their dad traveling all over the place, but they've been they've done us proud. And my colleague, Steve Curry, who was my right-hand man for 14 years, who just left last week to go to a job in Trinidad as lecturer in child health. So I wish him the best of luck. I'm not sure if he's here tonight, but I just wanted to acknowledge all of you here today in one way, one form or another, for your support and attention. Thank you very much.
Well, Mitch, I'm here on behalf of everybody else here to offer us Firstly, very many thanks for a most wonderful lecture, and an important lecture. And I see it's been recorded and videoed and everything else. And I hope that many people will have a chance to learn from it. Because you've put together some of the factors behind some of our great problems today in our nation. They're not just problems of national finance, which is always with us. They're problems to do with national will and a sorting out of what is important. We all know our dear national health services and universities waste money. They don't always know where to focus. And it does take extraordinary people. Mitch Blair, you're a shining example of this, who are able to cut through this to find where the realities are. What can be done? What can be done that has a rapid early spin-off? A university professor is an aspiration of many parents, and congratulations, Blair parents, who I first met also about 34 years ago. The title of professor does open certain doors. It does sometimes just let in a person with an unconventional mind who has new ideas to sort of get onto the stage. And Mitch, you've grabbed every opportunity that was there to become what you are now. And it's done through just sheer, persistent, hard work. There are two people sitting next to you who Mitch acknowledges had to have some necessary neglect. But I'm not convinced that a little bit of child neglect in very skillful hands can be very educational. That's just from my own experience. The other bit that it does having a little discussion with Simon Crowell beforehand is to help our next generation of parents become less neurotic than you are now. It's very difficult to sort all this stuff out, particularly from the newspapers, which delight in telling you today's anxiety, scandal, ignorance, neglect. But not to, first, their greatest sin is they don't tell you who really is behind this piece of research they picked up as today's story. And it is our duty to look beyond the headlines. So I'm just wondering where I've got to, because this job is a bit like Mr. Corbyn this afternoon. He had the chance for the inspector, and then he had to get up onto autopilot and speak. So I have cut out a great deal of what I originally written. There's one thing I just want to get into slightly joke time now. Mitch, you are entitled to an honour through Lufthansa Airlines. Have you been on Lufthansa Airline? It gives you a multiple choice question to fill in of what your status in the world. It starts with sort of minister of state and high priests, and very soon it gets down to professors. And then the line below is professor, professor. And if you really want to be given a very good seat up at the front of the aeroplane, it's professor, professor, doctor. So Mitch, that's one little advantage you can take. Now, you see, Mitch has two chairs. I mean, he really deserves more than this, but two is enough to get on with after that. I'm sure it's... So you are a professor at the University of West London, which you've been for a long time, actually, And now Imperial have had the very good sense to make you among their elect. And I, on behalf of us all, we'd like to wish you all the very best for your time as professor of these institutions. Anybody who likes to know more about Mitch, I recommend reading his CV. It is 53 pages long in 0.9 print and very expensive to print out on your computer, but I did it. And please look at his list of publications. There are about 90 or so in journals. And what I really drew attention to was paper number 79 in the Lancet of 1995. Mitch, do you know which paper I'm referring to?
The lunch.
Yes. Its title is Gourmet Lunches Boost Staff Morale. And that is very typical of Mitch because you know a truth. If your staff are enjoying their work and have some fun out of the work, they will work for you far harder than if you're an old misery. And we've all met old miseries in our times. You've been a very attentive and interested audience, but you were spared the fate of a friend of mine who got a chair in Holland. In Holland, it's a policy to invite people who may be affected with the conditions that you're interested in. He was talking on Tourette syndrome. You all know what Tourette syndrome is. The problem is the lecture was much delayed by a good deal of rather agricultural swearing in Dutch. So you were saved that. You've inspired your friend, re-inspired or kept the inspiration going from your many friends. I'm not sure if anybody actually came here just out of the cold. If you did, well, I hope that too was appreciated and you'll work on this. So Mitch, I think you'll let off for the time now. I don't think you're supposed to be asked questions after a university professor's inaugural lecture. So I think we could say goodbye, but thank you very much for our continuing higher education.
Well, and drinks. I have to thank Penny. I don't know if Penny's in the, but Penny Fletcher has actually organised this whole thing. So do go upstairs. There's some drinks, refreshments, a buffet, and I'm sure you're very hungry and thirsty. Come and join.